Well, tonight's talk, whose title escapes me.
The title was Kahneman's Case Against the Human Race.
The very one. It should be given by Mr. David McDonagh in a new venue, an elevated one, with comfy chairs. And here to give an uncomfortable talk to our opponents is Mr. David McDonagh. And the title is?
Daniel Kahneman's Case Against the Human Race.
Ah, same as it was.
Same as it was a few minutes ago.
Fine.
The history of economics is really the history of people who hate economics, writing economics, and become adopted by economics, a bit like the Conservative Party, you could say. You know, the Conservative Party adopts everyone who opposes them and eventually ends up with a ragtag and bobtail sort of thing. And Kahneman, actually, in his Fast and Slow Thinking, which is the book I'm more or less reviewing here, he actually quotes John von Neumann, who published a book called The Theory of Games and Economic Behaviour in 1944 with an economist called Oscar Morgenson. And this theory of games was an attack on economics. But now it's part of your undergraduate economics degree. If you were to do an undergraduate degree at university, it's called game theory, and it's considered a sort of part of economics, certainly part of mathematics, but certainly it's the part of mathematics that economists will have to master in an undergraduate degree. And again, you know, some of the outstanding classics of economics. Marx wasn't alone when he wrote a big book which was essentially a critique of economics, although Marx himself wasn't adopted by the economist profession, although he features in Histories of Economic Thought because the author wants to put him in. But Marx wasn't adopted like this, but Marx wasn't on his own in writing a critique of or a criticism of economics. Walras, who's one of the outstanding economists and innovated the marginal utility in the 1870s, along with Jevons in England and Menger in Austria, in Switzerland he innovated it. He started off as a socialist who was dead against economics, and he ended up as one of them, as it were. You know, and indeed, Schumpeter, writing his History of Economic Thought, claims that Walras is about the best economist so far as he was concerned. So Daniel Kahneman, who's a psychologist rather than an economist, was awarded the Nobel Prize for economics. That's quite typical. But anyway, what Kahneman doesn't like about economics, and what a lot of people don't like about economics, is the idea that it assumes that people are rational. Now, Kahneman himself says in the book, as I say, he's advertised the book and by a number of radio and television programs, in which I think the producers have taken more of a case against the human race than Kahneman wants to take. So my title was probably a bit of hyperbole, really. It was over the top, because it was based upon TV programs and radio programs rather than the book. They started talking about how silly and backward the human race were and how terrible they were and how irrational they were and so on. But that's not Kahneman's idea at all. He says in the book, in one sentence, he says, "I always cringe when people say that I'm stand up for human irrationality." He says, "because I think basically humans are roughly rational," you know, which I think is, you know, is fair comment. But of course, as he says elsewhere in the book, he's not all that consistent, really. But as he says elsewhere in the book, any psychologist will have as common sense that humans are irrational. but anyway, you know, he's not going to make too much of a fuss about human irrationality. What he thinks is that the basic assumptions of rational expectation theory are probably wrong, and he's got reasons for saying that, which I'll outline shortly. But the human rational expectation theory is not all that old when it comes to economics. You know, most of the economists, all of the economists in most of the histories of economics will not have heard of human rational expectation theory. You know, a lot of these ideas are new ideas since the war. If you open the textbook today, you'll imagine that the JMP and so on, like that, gross national product and so on, is all that they all go back way, but they don't go back all that far. You'll hardly find a textbook. In fact, I don't know a single textbook in the 19th century, although there might be one that refutes me, that mentions gross national product. I don't know how old the idea of gross national product is. I do know that it was adopted in textbooks in America and in Britain after 1945, certainly, and it must have been around before then. But how far it goes back, I don't know. The economics has been a mixed profession. Gary Becker once said, in relation to rationality and irrationality in economics, it doesn't matter whether people are irrational or not, you still have a downward sloping demand curve. In other words, he was saying, the basic economic theory will work whether people, whether you count people irrational or not. It doesn't, economics is about economics, the external economic problem, rather than psychology. Now, it is true that psychology is the where value resides, economics isn't an analysis of value. It's perfectly correct that that, for example, the costs, the value of a holiday might not be the same to any two people in this room, but that's their psychological differences between the two people. That will be an opportunity cost to me may well be. Someone looking at me might say, well, I'd be foolish to neglect this particular opportunity, but it might be an opportunity that I want to neglect. So these costs are subjective. Costs do depend upon the mind, finally, so there's an overlap then of Venn circles where there'll be an overlap between economics and psychology in that department. But basically, the economic problem itself, making ends meet and having more output than inputs, which is basically economics, is nothing to do with psychology, but to do with what actually is occurs in the external world. And the economic problem itself is a problem of the world. And if we imagine, as socialists usually imagine, that there is a superabundance, or even Keynes said that in places, rather stupidly, he should have known better. But even Keynes said the problem of production is over and we have got an abundance. Well, if we did have an abundance, there'd be no economic problem. And we still have, I should imagine, different psychologies and so on. And it'd be different, it wouldn't mean they're all the same or something, or that human nature was different in any way, shape or form. We just wouldn't have any economic problem because there'd be an abundance. But what we have got, sadly, is scarcity. And the nature of scarcity, we were talking about this earlier on before the talk, is that you have receding metaphorical breadlines. Not only do we feel poor, but a millionaire feels poor. He has his own metaphorical breadlines. No one's got enough money. No one's got enough wealth because we have the economic problem. And future generations will make all this progress. We've made all this progress now in the last 300 years. Yet we still feel as badly off as I guess they felt 300 years ago. And this is likely to be the case in 300 years in the future. We'll have all sorts of different things, but we'll still feel the economic problem. So the economic problem is basically an external thing, and it depends upon our values, but basically there is an overlap between psychology. But basically psychology, the sort of psychology he's talking about, is not really all that germane to economics itself, although there is some of it which is germane to some economic ideas, and I'll cover them in a minute. Now, first of all, give an exposition of Kahneman, and then I'll give a slight criticism of him. I'll give a more harsher criticism of his television and radio programs than I have done on the LA list, in fact. well, you know, a more mild criticism of the book. And about two-thirds of the he's got three basic ideas, and only one of them concerns economics, and so I suppose only one of them was what he won the Nobel Prize for. One of them is his major thesis in the book, and his major distinction is between fast and slow thinking. Thinking Fast and Slow is the title of the book. And this is between what he calls, which he gets from a man called, forgotten the chap's name, but the chap come out with System 1 and System 2, and then he went up to Process 1 and Process 2. And Kahneman has adopted this. I've forgotten the chap's name now. But the chap who then he split the chap who he took it from, split the process two into two parts, the attentive and the normal and the enthusiastic, you could say. That wasn't his words, but that sums up his the dedication. Now I'll now outline what they mean by the System 1 and System 2, or Process 1 and Process 2. And I'll use my own names for them. I think that most of us, most of our thinking, most of the time is tacit. We couldn't... In order for me to actually sum up everything I see now in words would take me a long time, and the words would be linear, whereas everything I can see now is panoramic. And... I see it in an instant. So in order for me to sum up my mind's content now, it would take me quite a long time, and it could take me even years. And some of it could be a very big book. It's really boring, I should imagine. Still, most things we think about are not worth talking about anyway. I mean, I don't... if I meet Stephen Bell, I don't tell him that my feet were feeling a bit warm yesterday, or I had six cups of coffee. These are things. Most of what we think about is not worth talking about. We only talk about things that are worth talking about. So basically, most of our thought is tacit. And this Kahneman calls System 1. System 1 is the tacit, rapid thinking, intuition. He calls it intuitive thinking, which we go by intuition. We weigh up things Now he wants to say. Now he, the other form of thinking is explicit, using word thinking, which is slower and takes time. Now, so we have an equal and addition sum, for example, one and one. We can work that out too, just by without thinking. Tacitly we can work. Whereas if we have a massive multiplication sum. 500 by 766. It's probably not hard, we could do it, but we might need a pen and paper. Or even if we can do it in our mind, we might take us a bit longer than the one and one makes two. And we might, even if we do it without pen and paper, we might utilize what he calls System 2, which is, the more, the slower, more careful thinking, more cautious thinking. Now, Kahneman wants to say, first of all, he wants to say that these are just heuristic devices. They're not real. Freud says that about the unconscious, oddly enough. And of course, there is a similarity between System 1 and System 2 and the unconscious and the conscious mind. And Freud says in his introductory lectures to psychoanalysis that the unconscious doesn't actually exist. It's just an explanatory thing. And Kahneman says the same of System 1 and System 2. They're not parts of the brain or something. They're just an explanatory thing of how human beings are. And again, his friend who we took this from made a division between system within System 2, that there was an enthusiastic portion, where, like a keen chess player who's really switched on to the game, as it were, or a keen philosopher who switched on to a philosophical problem, a keen mathematician who switched on to the problem, who's thinking and really going ahead and is occupied. But most people are not like that. Even the keen chess player or keen mathematician, for other problems, when he uses System 2, he uses it, and Cameron makes a big fuss about this, he uses it in a very lazy fashion. It's not all that pleasant. I'm almost going to bring out a contradiction in Kahneman here. because we're almost not at home with System 2. We're at home in System 1. That's where we have the U's. However, and this is a contradiction in Kahneman, Kahneman says he himself, and he thinks most people, identify themselves and feel at home with System 2. When they think about themselves, they think in terms of System 2. And they tend to overlook System 1 completely, he thinks. Now, this could be that he had an early good education. The whole system is a bit similar to another thinker. There was a thinker in sociology in the 1960s called Basil Bernstein. And this Basil Bernstein had an analysis of language called the elaborate and the restricted code. And basically, the people who Bernstein called the working class had a restricted code. Basically, what he really meant is he less educated. Whereas the people who were the middle class or university educated or professional class had an elaborate code. And now I think this is perfectly right, you know. I don't think there is a working class. I mean, Marx thought there was a working class, economic interest group. I think that's just a mistake. You know, there is no economic interest group called the working class. There is diverse interests within what is called the working class. And these interests are so diverse that they refute the idea of the working class. But anyway, Basil Bernstein thought he was elaborating, he thought he was analysing the working class, and he said they had a restricted code. And he said they also expect to be understood. When they say hoi or you or are inexplicit, they are disappointed when they're not completely understood. Whereas someone who was what Basil Bernstein calls the middle class or the professional class may well be able to interpret these people and make sense out of what they say. But anyway, if they're talking to another member of the middle class, they'll be far more explicit. And now this is a bit like System 1 and System 2. The System 1 is restricted code and you're not bothering much with words. And System 2 is bothering with words. But Kahneman says that even the... he says, first of all, he says we're at home with System 2, we identify with it. But then he more or less spells out at length that, he actually says that System 1 is the hero of the book. And he says that explicitly, and he more or less spells out that we are far more at home in actual fact. This is a bit of an inconsistency in his book. And we are far more at home with System 1. And I myself, I'm afraid that... Yeah, the poet Southey said, no matter how long you live, the first 20 years is the longest half of your life. And that is Robert Southey, the first poet laureate. And if you look at time in psychological terms, that's sort of true. And certainly the first 20 years when you're brought up now, I was pretty inarticulate, I think, for my first 20 years. And so I'm not at all surprised to think that I feel certainly at home, far more at home, in what Kahneman calls System 1 than in System 2. And I think that Kahneman does as well, and he more or less says so he more or less says so in many places throughout the book, that everyone, including himself, is far more at home with System 1, and that System 2 is a bit of a pain in the neck that will cut down, unless we're very interested, like a chess problem or a maths problem or something that we take a particular interest in. Then System 2 will go, will get engaged. But generally speaking, System 1 is where we're at home. And we don't want to put ourselves out. I mean, there's even terrible expressions for this. I won't bring them up here. People not being bothered and what they mean, they're not going to be bothered to think in System 2. So that's his main distinction. Now that's we've got. He uses that with his criticism of economics, but that's really got nothing to do with economics. He has another distinction which has got nothing to do with economics, and that's his distinction between experience as it's lived and experience as it's recalled. And he reckons these conflict completely and utterly. And he's even done some experiments on this. One was what he calls the water experiment, where he gets people to put their hands in cold water, which is unpleasantly cold but not terribly painfully cold, and they keep it up for 60 minutes. And then he gets the same people later to put their hands in cold water, the same cold water, but this time for, sorry, 60, did I say 60 minutes? No, I don't think it's 60, it might be 60 minutes. Hell, that's a long time.
That's worse than Guantanamo, this.
He gets them later on to put their hand in for 90 minutes, which is even longer. But in the last 30 minutes, he puts in some warm water. So the last 30 minutes is more pleasant. And he gets them to choose which experience they thought was the best. Now, invariably, he says, they choose the 90-minute one as the most pleasant experience. So their memories become indifferent to duration, whereas common sense would say that the duration matters more. And so therefore, then, he sees a conflict like this between how we recall things and how we experience them as we go along. And he has a look at Le Traviata, the opera based on Alexander Dumas' Fils, the son of Alexander Dumas, who wrote this book about a young man meeting a prostitute and falling in love with her, and the young man's father persuading the prostitute not to ruin the young man's career, and especially the young man's sister, who was about to get married, if it became common knowledge. So she asked, he asked the lady to pack up, to get rid of the suitor, who was the young man, his son. And she did so because she loved the young man. She, it's one of these things, because she loved the young man, she decided to get rid of him for his own good and for his sister's good and for his family's good. She suddenly dies of consumption or tuberculosis.
It seems longer on the stage when she's singing. Sorry, dude.
Yeah. the question is she's dying of tuberculosis, and this chap has got to visit her before she dies. And Kahneman says that those last few minutes are worth more than her whole life. And he says this is the way out. This is something that the common sense of counting time duration wouldn't agree with, but the common sense of the other common sense of memory equal, would agree with. So this is a big clash between how we recall things, which is often can be based on the last day or two of a holiday, or for example, we might be in, I don't know, say we're in a remand home or an approved school, and it's awful most of the time, but we make some friends there, and we leave in with some friends and a network and so on. And we might recall that approved school 10 years later as being far worse than it actually was when we were experiencing it there. There is a clash between the experience self and the memory. So that's his other distinction. Now, the last third of the distinction is where it comes to the clash with economics. And that's this. He thinks that there's a clash between, and he gets this from Richard Thalia, who was a behavioural economist, gets a clash between econs and humans. Now, he's taking the humans from the, there's a bit of spin, there's lots of spin in the book, by the by. And he himself shows that he's very politically correct in many respects throughout the book, which includes a lot of spin. And one of the spins is the clash between econs and humans. Now, as he's got this idea of humans from psychology, he could say the clash between econs and psychos. That wouldn't go down so well, would it? The clash between econs and psychos. One would expect the psychos to be doing not so well there. But he wants the econs not to be doing not so well. The econs are the villains of the piece, as it were. They're the rational people. And people, as they really are, that is, humans, he calls them, rather than psychos. His chief thing here is the difference that most of us have, which I think is a true thing, between gains and losses. Most of us would sooner, if we had a choice between a scenario where we lose 5 shillings, or a scenario where we gain 5 shillings.
Not here.
No, a scenario where we gain 5 shillings or we lose 5 shillings, we would choose the if we had a straight bet between losing and gaining 5 shillings. Most of us wouldn't bet 5 shillings for 5 shillings, he says, because he thinks that we'd sooner not lose 5 shillings than gain 5 shillings.
Then not gain 5 shillings.
No, than gain 5 shillings. It's true that what you say is also true. You'd agree with that as well. But what he says in the book is that he has a scenario where it's all win. He says that's nice. But would sooner avoid the place where it's all lose than to accept the situation where it's all win. And of course, if it's 50-50, a bet of 5 shillings, then most of us wouldn't like that. He says no. And he says this with some certainty. I think it's true of some people. It's certainly true of someone like me. I don't like betting, but it might not be true of others. There are a few eccentrics who probably like betting. In fact, I know people who bet all day long, and they're bound to lose, and they still bet all day long. In these casino things, they turn any amount of money in these casino things, and they go in there all day long. Where it's obvious. Now, I think that Kahneman would explain them by saying they're fooled in some sort of way. Whether they are fooled or not, I don't know. But anyhow, they keep going back there day after day and pouring all their money in these one-armed bandit type things. But anyway, he says this with a certain amount of certainty that people would. And he says a good chess player would sooner, hates defeat. And he hates defeat far more than he likes victory. That's the idea. So we hate to lose. We like to win, but elation in winning is nowhere near disappointment in losing. And what he's saying is there's an asymmetry between gains and loss. Now, what he wants to say about Econ is that they think they're the same, that Econ would say gains is the same as loss. Now, there probably are some rational expectations theories that might say that. I don't know offhand. I know there's a lot of economists that would probably agree with Kahneman. But anyway, this is one of the... He picks out of all people a mathematician, a Swiss mathematician called Bellini, who did a bit on utility back in the early 18th century. He praises Bellini to begin with, saying that the thing he does positively is perfectly all right. But he overlooks the fact that losses are not equal to gains. That people hate losses more than they hate gains. And this is his basic criticism of Econ, that they think that things are equivalent, which are not equivalent according to most human beings. And that's probably true, but I think there'll be no end of economists that agree with him on that, and it wouldn't affect their economic theory at all. But still, this is what he says, and so his main thesis then is that there's a difference between gains and loss, and Econs want to dodge that. Then he says that then he does go on to some of the post-war economic theory, perfect competition and so on, where it has been said by some economists, not by all economists, but by some economists, that there is perfect knowledge and so on. This is there are other economists, which are actually the Austrian economists, don't go along with this so much. The economic calculation argument, which is a big thing in the Austrian economists, is just about ignorance and so on. And the economics of ignorance and so on, which rejects this perfect competition. But still, there are some economists, Samuelson and others, who do say that that there is perfect knowledge and so on. And he says that he has something in his statement that Econ might say that there's perfect knowledge and so on, and that it's less likely we're going to make mistakes. And of course, he criticizes that as being unrealistic. Someone like Friedman would probably say, Milton Friedman would probably say that it's you know, say a bit like what he says about System 1 and System 2. It's a sort of heuristic. It's not meant to be true, literally true, but it helps us to explain things. That's what that's that. You know, Friedman says this in positive economics when he's he doesn't mean that positive economics is absolutely true. He holds it like Kahneman holds System 1 and System 2. So, you know, so but anyhow, he, Kahneman has a look at the fact that this is not real. And so along those lines, he thinks that humans are more error-prone. And then he does make out a case against libertarianism. He says that libertarianism thinks that people can handle their own lives. And, you know, Kahneman tends to think that, that he and his friends in behavioral economics realises that the state can help people out tremendously. He overlooks the fact that the state's taxing people. He tends to think that all this he overlooks the various moral problems that the libertarians will point out with all this, and this man Richard Taylor, who's taken this from, has written a book called Nudge, which you might have heard of.
Oh, yes.
That's the sort of thing that Kahneman, I suppose, would favour. You know, the state should give nudges to people to get them to do more saving and so on. And so he favours that sort of stuff. So that's basically what I said. Now, my criticism of him is this, that he wants to say that System 1 is automatic, which I think is correct. But he also wants to say, he doesn't say it coherently, because like he often hints throughout the book, that his real home and everyone's real home is in System 1 rather than in System 2, as he insists explicitly. So he also insists in various places, he hints in various places throughout the book, that System 1, that is tacit thinking, is subject to rapid change. Now, so he says both that it never changes and it's subject to rapid change. Now, I think the latter half of that contradiction is correct. Our tacit thought is usually corrected by when we use our five senses. We inform ourselves, now in a trivial way, of course. I look around the room, I inform myself but it does actually change my mind when I look around the room to take things in. I change my mind by my five senses insist me to revise what's on my mind. And most of our mind is taken up by perception. And so we do change. We System 1 must be something which is evolving. Now, he has a section where he says we have certain primers and we're primed by our environment. And our environment primes us in ways that we don't realise. So if I mention a figure, say, 110, and then I ask you how old Gandhi was when he died, that 110 might influence you to, if you don't know. I mean, you could know how old Gandhi was in this case. Gandhi.
Oh, Gandhi.
The Indian.
I thought it was a dandy, which is three names.
Oh, beg your pardon. Oh. No, beg your pardon. I mean, the Gandhi, the Indian chap.
Yeah, yes.
He's quite old when he died.
Mohandas K. Gandhi.
Yeah.
Right.
And great soul, isn't he? Great soul, Gandhi. But anyway, Gandhi. Then this 110 will influence you to give a figure for when Gandhi dies. Now he says, what you don't realise is that when you change from room to room, you're getting different primes or different settings which are influencing your System 1. Now, I think this is perfectly correct, but it doesn't clash well with his idea that System 1 never changes and we can't switch it off. I think it's true that we can't switch it off. But it's changing all the time. And he wants to say that it's permanent, that it locks us, that it fools us, that there's a sense in which it's very hard to change System 1. And he does want to say, he has the Muller-Lyer illusion. And he says, I think quite rightly, but this is the way how he presents System 1, which is, I think, in a way which is not really realistic. He has the Muller... I mean, you've all seen the Muller-Lyer illusion.
This is a book I want to read, but not to buy.
This book?
Yes.
Oh, you can borrow it off me. In this case, you don't have to buy it.
I don't think it's worth buying.
Well, it probably isn't worth buying.
Get it from the library.
Get it from the library.
I'm not sure it's worth reading.
Oh, well, in that case.
But it's worth hearing about.
Yeah. There is the Muller illusion. I mean, I thought I could find it very quickly, but I can't. You know, where the two lines... Yeah, you know, the Muller illusion. You know the Muller illusion. Two lines are...
apparently parallel.
Apparently parallel. Well, they are parallel. They're parallel, and but one goes...
You can make them look not so parallel.
Well, it isn't so much that they don't look parallel.
Oh, one's longer than the other. Yeah.
One, they're the same length, but one looks longer than the other. And, I thought I could find it in the book, and it's funny, it has a whole page in the book. So I thought I'd just show you in the book, and it'd take up a whole page, and it'd have been all right. I couldn't find the bloody page.
You've done it. No.
But anyway, he says that even when we know, even when we've measured it, and we look at it, it still looks as though one is longer than the other. Now, I think that's perfectly correct. But he uses this to show that we can't upset System 1 very well. But, you know, now I think this is, it's not too bad to say we can't consciously upset System 1 very well. But he wants to say that System 1 is permanent. And of course it's not. It changes, as he points out when he says we're primed by different surroundings. It changes all the time by different surroundings. And by, you know, so I think that's a fault with him. He wants to make System 1 more stable than it is. That is my main criticism of him, actually. Because I have an analysis myself which is similar to System 1 and System 2, and where I do say that System 1 is superior.
Ah, well, we have enough to chew on, I think. Well, thank you, David. Come to the questions.
See, I haven't actually read the book, but when he says you can't change System 1, does he not mean that you can change the fact that it reacts instinctively rather than seeing the actual content as the same? Do you know what I mean?
But he also flouts that. He wants to say that. But he also flouts that as well, because he says we can train, and if we're well trained, System 1 will knuckle under it. Yeah, in other words, if a trained economist might master, I mean, not all economists do. I mean, actually, there was a little test in that economists. The economist, is it Robert Frank? There's an economist called Robert Frank, who's also a mathematician. He's written a number of popular books, The Economist's Behaviour and so on. And he has a little test in his first of one of these books. And he reckons, he's got a written question on opportunity cost, he reckons most economists fail it. And I don't know whether that's true or not, but it's a bit of a scandal if they do. But I wouldn't be. There's a similar book called Innumeracy by John Allen Polos, who has a little test on mathematics, and he reckons most mathematicians fail the little elementary test on mathematics. Actually, Kahneman could explain this. They don't like System 2, even when it's their own subject. They prefer System 1. And of course, you know, if you think fast, you can fail. You can easily overlook sunk costs, opportunity cost, and concepts like that. They're easy to overlook. But he reckons that he does actually say, with the sunk cost thing, he says that an economist who's trying to understand sunk costs will comprehend them even with his System 1. So he even flouts that, you see. He's not all that consistent in what he says. But he's much more... I like the fact that he does say, I cringe when people accuse me of accusing the human race of being irrational, so I better not do it too much.
Question here.
Yeah, David, you say he's kind of against, he makes a case against humanity, and it's clear that his experiments prove that System 1 is, if you can change it, it's slow. I think the psychological consensus is that System 1 is kind of programmed in your early years. The younger you are, the more you're basically not programmed. And then within your youth, until you're about in your mid-20s, the System 1 is programmed. And after that, it becomes very inflexible, which tends to go with all kinds of... I think the Catholic Church already realized that you shouldn't try to... convert people beyond the age of 25, because it doesn't work very well, because they are already very much programmed in the System 1. But even if it, whether it's stable or not, I don't understand why it's such a big problem for you that he assumes that it is stable.
It's only that I think that's false. is that it's falsely stable. Apart from that, system one is perfectly all right for me. As I say, I have a philosophy of my own that is similar to system one, called tacit thinking, except that I don't think it's stable. But by the Catholic Church, it was Iola who said that, give me a boy until he's seven and he'll be a Catholic for life. He was given Voltaire, of course, he didn't turn out to be a Catholic for life. He was brought up in a Jesuit college. And Keynes has got this idea as well that when you're over 30, you stop thinking. I don't think it's true. I think
Keynes wrote his most famous works past the age of 30, I should say.
He did, yeah. And Russell also said, until I was 40, I didn't think that language mattered much, and then I thought that the language is the most important thing in philosophy. I remember reading that and thinking, well, Russell was all right before he was 40. But I don't think Kahneman would necessarily agree with you there that people become set in their ways. There's nothing remotely like a case for human beings to be set in their ways in this book. I mean, Kahneman's not saying anything. He might say it elsewhere, but he says nothing like remotely like that in the book. But I think it's wrong anyway. I think Loyola and the Catholic Church are wrong about human beings.
They're certainly wrong in the sense that you can change people a lifetime, but it slows down significantly, and I think this is shown in tests.
Well, it's very hard to, unless there's some edge, if you meet a person who's going towards your way of thinking anyway. I mean, Confucius said, he said something like, go to plant crops, allow a few months. Go to build a house, allow at least 10 years. Go to change human beings, allow a whole lifetime. It's very often the case. It takes ages to take change people, unless they're going your way to begin with.
With the lines that the same length, do you see them currently as a different length, knowing all that you know?
Do I see them? Yes.
How do you see them? You drew them. You know they're the same length. How do you see them?
Oh, I think I agree with him that I know they're false. It's a bit like if I had a lot of beer and I saw some pink elephants. I'd know the pink elephants were false, but I still see them.
Correct. Only that effect is temporary. This one's more permanent.
Yes, that's true. Mm.
But you see, they've done this experiment with some people in Africa who live in a very flat desert and build round houses. So they never when they grow up, they don't come across like we do corners, which is the effect why we see one is longer than that. So they don't know corners, and they showed those people those two lines, and made a suggestion question: which one is longer? And they looked at them like, what do you mean, which one is longer? They're clearly both the same length.
Yeah.
So we have learned to see these things this way.
Yeah.
And once we have learned it, even if you know it rationally, you seem to not be able to unlearn this.
Not in the short run, anyway, yeah. Not in the short run. I mean, neither of us are going to bother to take time to keep looking at the bloody lines until we see them as the same. But if we did, in other words, if we retrained ourselves, we probably would train ourselves out of the illusion. You can, he admits that you can train yourself out of certain illusions.
But it's very hard.
No,
it's very, very easy to learn. That's the whole thing. I mean, if you have, for example, traumatized people from experience in war, or they've witnessed some horrible stuff. This horrible stuff they witnessed, went in very short time. You see atrocities happening. They suffer their whole lives. They need psychologists to try to make them forget this stuff, and they can't forget it, and it influences them their whole life, because it's very easy to learn something and that programs your system one, especially if emotions are involved. This exaggerates the program, but it's very difficult to unlearn stuff. That's the point.
But then most people there at the front didn't suffer from this shell shock, did they? They didn't suffer from these sort of
Many soldiers don't kill anybody.
Well, not everyone.
Only other individual.
But the point is, you've learned something that is traumatizing, and although you want to unlearn it because it's really having a bad influence on your life, lots of people cannot forget these things over a decade, and it only took them a very short time to learn it.
I think most people don't get these shell shocks, but secondly. if I'm struggling with a problem and I don't overcome it, given a number of decades, it doesn't mean that if I didn't take a slightly different route, you know, I had someone like Rivers or something like that who was an expert in this sort of business, and he'd give me a little hint and so on, that I might, with different treatment, I might have got rid of it pretty sharper, more sharp. You never know.
But it didn't happen.
It hasn't happened in some cases.
I must ask a question. What is the great implication for laissez-faire economics that's supposed to arise from this?
It arises only from the third of the book. That's the economists versus humans. And basically it's saying that humans can't look after themselves. They need the state.
Okay. And that's supposed to follow from the first two parts of the
book? No, the first two parts have got nothing to do with economics.
Plainly, yes.
He doesn't pretend that they have.
Yes.
Sorry, why can't they look after themselves? Because they're too wedded to system one.
And because they can't solve problems. They make too many mistakes. They don't know what's best for themselves. The elite knows a bit better than they do.
Right.
That sort of thing. I think that's oversimplified it a bit. I've been a bit prude to him there, but that's basically the nugget.
But the market's not averse to using the ideas of
other people.
Certain elitist thinking.
Yeah.
To improve production.
Oh, I do.
And enable all these people who are grovelling around in System One to continue, and yet become better off.
Yep. Oh, that's perfectly correct, yeah. I mean, he doesn't have much of a case against the market. But a lot of people just don't like economics. And anything that's...
He doesn't like the market rather than doesn't like economics.
He doesn't like the market. He likes the market. He's one of these moderate people, like a Guardian reader. He'll admit that the market is necessary. But on the whole, you can see merit in John Ruskin's work as well. It's physical of the market, that sort of thing. You know, it's the market is necessary. He's not a socialist or anything. But he does think that government's got a good role.
As I see it, people are doing nothing but solving problems all of their lives, for the most part. Sometimes you can't solve a problem and you die. Or you're solving all sorts of problems and you die anyway. But things manufactured by profit-seeking entrepreneurs don't do you any harm in this regard. They're either of use to you or they're of no use to you. They're very rarely of harm to you directly. What is really being claimed here? I mean, you can make use of the intelligence of other people. You can make use of the speed of thought of other people. You don't have to do it all yourself. You make use of things you can't design and can't build. What's the difficulty in not being as the smartest on the block? You can be good looking, you can be lucky in love. You can. There's all sorts of ways of getting on in the world.
What he's saying is that libertarians would disagree with people like who wrote that thing Nudge.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they'd be against taxing elites taxing and nudging people this way and the other. They want to leave them alone, and he thinks it'd be better. People would be happier. If they had people like Thalia and others, giving them proper taxing them and giving them proper nudges to save a bit more and to basically go to the right schools and so on,
that could be available for people who wish to be nudged around. I don't know how many would choose that form of life.
Isn't advertising nudging anyway?
It's give it a chance, but it's not saying we've chosen for you. I think you'll find, if you're intelligent enough, this is what you want, and if you haven't found this what you want, that's because you're not intelligent enough, so we'll do it for you.
Well,
that's
my,
more than, that's
my
more
own
this.
Opinion on advertising is very passive. You know, advertising is part of production, it's part of distribution, and it rings a big bell and draws attention to the goods. But if you don't want the goods, for example, I've been watching advertisements for Playtex Living Bra all my life. I've never bought one yet or even thought of buying one.
I need one.
This thing is just advertising in another form.
Nudge.
Like Nico says, the corner, seeing corners in the line. I mean, this is just something it's just something that you were told at the very beginning that has been propagated. The lines being the same length. It's just advertising in another form. It's not for soda. It's for lines that are different length. It's the same nudge.
Well, I'm not sure that advertising does give us a... I suppose it does give us a nudge. It reminds us there are goods there to be...
You're impervious to the bra, but you're not impervious to the line. I wonder why.
Well, I don't think that I don't think that it pays to advertise. I mean, I try to advertise these meetings to some extent, but I don't think that the advertisements for these meetings do, unless they're already inclined that way, do much to persuade people to come along. What they do is they tell them that it's there if they want to come along. I think advertisements work like that. They're part of distribution. They're like lollies. Distributed things from one city to another.
Well,
they
plant things in people's minds, though, because you said you've never wanted to buy a Playtex brand, but you remember Playtex to mention it. So I bet if you're
cross your heart, David,
to ring you up and say, "Oh, I need a new bra," you might go to shop and buy Playtex just because that's the name in your mind.
I might.
You know, so it kind of works in that respect.
Yeah.
But I want to say, you just said that people manufacture things, you buy it, you don't buy it, it doesn't harm you, but some things do harm you. Look at the pollution levels in London.
Oh, yes.
And the things the food industry are doing.
Whether or not, yes, where certain property rights in the self are disregarded by those who poison you and other things, yes. But very few libertarians would argue against bringing injunctions against those who pollute or poison or things of that kind.
But involves government regulation, which...
Need not, I think...
London...
Well, of course...
People with
that's...
Yes... We've already exceeded
the years... Well, think of it this way. Coal... People died in the bringing up of coal. People died in the transportation of coal. People died in the fact that coal was used and caused smog and other things. Mm-hmm. But coal, amongst other things... lengthened human lives enormously and increased the population enormously. So on net, for example, coal, even though some uses should have been restricted, some pollution should have been reduced, even so, it made people live longer and healthier lives.
Okay,
so let's hear it for coal, is what I
said. About rural effects, and we didn't have as many alternatives available as we do now.
Yeah.
Now, I think it's much more cynical. It's like Volkswagen, and they're just the ones that got caught out. I'm sure they're all at it. They're like, oh, we're just going to...
Yeah, it's a very strange crime they committed.
And you don't need to.
I don't know who actually got hurt by it. I mean, they lied. I mean, in the sense they lied.
Two continents were burning
way
more than they thought they were. Whether it's good or bad, that's besides the point. The law was made, smart or unsmart.
Well,
compared to an American president, you know, blowing people to pieces on his hit list, you know.
Well, it was really just CO2 they were talking about.
Yeah,
CO2
is good for
the essence of
plants that. Like it a lot. You know. I can't knock it myself. We could adjourn to the bar at this point, I think.
Yeah,
we started late. Well, thank you very much, David.
Yes, you're welcome.